I ended part one making a reference to the timing of the video that discussed the verses in Isaiah chapter 40 that say that the people are grass. I said that there were 84 days that encompassed the day that he led me to produce this video and his first fruit harvest in the year 5772, which was in 2012 in the pagan calendar that most of you use. For those of you who have not watched other videos that talk about the significance of 84 days, the Most High has woven different 84-day periods of time into his end-time timeline that reflect the 84 hours that his only begotten Son was dead. Yeshua was in the tomb for 3 days and three nights, but the testimony of Kipri's word testifies that he was dead for 3.5 days, or for 84 hours. The 3.5 years of his witness against the scattered descendants of Israel are also symbolic of the 84 hours that Yeshua was dead. In lieu of Kipri's restoration of his 30-day calendar, I can assure you that it is not a coincidence that he set up his 3.5-year witness against you to encompass 1,260 days, which Revelation chapter 11 tells us are also 42 months. The math of this revelation equates to 42 30-day months. This is impossible to refute. This math and the Most High's restoration of his 30-day months a couple of years ago before his first fruit harvest is further proof that he has sent me. I thought that this show was over with at his first fruit harvest a couple years ago when he led me to restore his 30-day months prior to this harvest, so there was no way that I conjured this up. This is why he held some things like this back from me. He had to do so, otherwise you could say that I just fabricated his timeline on my own. The book of Job contains 42 chapters in it. Job stood upon his righteousness as his justification with the Most High during his time of affliction, and his three accusers condemned him for doing so. In chapter 42, we are told that Yahweh told Job's three accusers to offer up 7 bullocks and 7 rams and to ask Job to entreat him on their behalf in order that his anger at them for condemning his servant Job would be turned aside. He told them that what Job had spoken was established and that what they had spoken was not so. This is recorded in chapter 42, verse 7. Yahweh's word clearly establishes that we will all be justified by our righteousness or condemned for our lack of it. And his word establishes what righteousness is according to him. One of the places that it does so is in Ezekiel chapter 33. You, son of man, are the watchmen that I have set up to the house of Israel. Hear the word of my mouth and admonish them from me. He tells us in Ezekiel chapter 24 that the one who escapes from the captivity and brings his 5-point sign to your ears is the son of man. Say to the wicked, wicked man, dying you will die. If you do not speak to admonish the wicked of his way, that wicked man will die in his iniquity, in his lawlessness, but his blood I will require at your hand. If you admonish the wicked to turn from his way, if he does not turn from his way, he will die in his iniquity, in his lawlessness, but your life will be delivered. Sin is violation of Kipri's Torah. His word says so. Verse 10, thus you, son of man, speaking you shall speak to the house of Israel, saying, your rebellion to the Most High, and your sins are upon you, your transgressions against him are upon you, and you dwindle in them. Why should you live? Say to them, as I live, saith Adonai Yahweh, I do not delight in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked would turn from his way and live. Turn from your evil ways, house of Israel. Why die? You, son of man, say to the children of your people, the righteousness of the righteous will not deliver you in the day of your rebellion to the Most High. As for the wickedness of the wicked, you will not fall in the day that you turn from your wickedness. Neither will the righteous be able to live because of your righteousness in the day that you sin, in the day that you transgress against his Torah. Say to the righteous, living you will live. But if you trust in your righteousness and do iniquity, all of your righteousness will not be remembered. You will die for the iniquity or for the lawlessness that you have done. Say to the wicked, dying you will die. But if you will turn from your sin, turn from your transgressing against the Most High's Torah, and do that which is lawful and right, and if those of you who are wicked will turn back and pledge to repay that which you have robbed, and walk in the statutes of life without committing iniquity, without committing a lawlessness, living you will live, and you will not die. None of your sins that you have done will be remembered upon you if you do that which is lawful and right, and living you will live. If you want to put your eternal hopes in Saul of Tarsus, saved by grace apart from the works of the Torah doctrine instead, go right ahead and do so. Dying you will die. Yahweh's word testifies that Saul is the abomination that desolated his ward. Yeshua testified to the writings of Yahweh's prophets, and he prophesied against Saul coming on the scene to desolate his father's ward. In lieu of the significance that the Most High has established through the testimony of his word concerning 84 days, I can assure you that it is not a coincidence that 84 days encompassed the video, Yahweh's righteousness will endure forever, and his first fruit harvest. Nor is it a coincidence that in Yahweh's restored calendar, there are always 84 days that encompass his Feast of First Fruits and the last day of his Feast of Temporary Dwellings, which is the day that he has followed the beginning of the great and the fearful day of his wrath into next year. Next year's Feast of First Fruits that begins this 84-day countdown to the great and the fearful day of his wrath is the third such feast since Yahweh's first fruit harvest in the year 5772. His emphasis on the number 3 in his word speaks for itself. After Job's time of affliction ended, Yahweh restored unto him double. He gave him 14,000 sheep to replace the 7,000 that he had blessed him with before. He gave him 6,000 camels to replace the 3,000 that he had blessed him with before. He gave him 1,000 pairs of oxen and 1,000 she-asses to replace the 500 of each of these that he had blessed him with before. And he replaced Job's 7 sons and 3 daughters with 7 more sons and 3 more daughters. This is one of the many parallels of 3 and 7 that he wove into his word. And so is Job's 3 accusers having to offer up 7 rams and 7 bullocks. The significance of 3 and 7 is discussed in several of these videos, and how this significant ties in with his judgment and his water of separation statute for touching the dead, and how the statute ties in with his judgment against you at this time as well. Job lived for 140 years after his time of trouble was sent upon him. The Most High even wove these 140 years into his end time timeline. One third of Yahweh's 1260-day testimony of his restored 30-day months is 420 days, 10 times 42. A third of 420 days is 140 days. 140 days prior to the great and the fearful day of Yahweh's wrath next year will be the first day of the third month. In the last video, I pointed out that on the first day of the third month of this year, we were 500 days from the great and the fearful day of Yahweh's wrath. The first day of the third month is the day that he gave for his Ezekiel chapter 31 Son of Man prophecy. I will discuss this prophecy in another video. There was a fourth man that also chimed in with Job's three accusers to give Job his opinion, but Yahweh excluded this man in his rebuke of the other three. As for the three-fourths of you who do not receive Yahweh's mark, that are not part of the one-fourth of you that will die in the manner of the fourth seal, you will still die, and you will still be burnt up. But the fourth seal singles out a fourth part of you that will not have to endure all of what the rest of you who also do not have his mark will endure. It will be better to be of this fourth part than it will be for those of you who will be a partaker of that which will result from the fifth trumpet. This is for sure. And the rest of the calamity that will be heaped upon you for that matter. The fifth trumpet tells us that there will be a time that those of you who do not have Yahweh's mark that remain will seek death because of your affliction, but you will not be able to find it. Job sought death during his affliction as well, but there is a big difference between Job and nearly all of you. Job stood upon Yahweh's righteousness that his word establishes. He did so even when he was given over to suffer great affliction. Most of you could care less about Yahweh's righteousness. Job refused to curse Yahweh. The revelations of Yeshua tell us in chapter 16 that those of you who are the recipients of the fourth and the fifth vial of Yahweh's wrath are going to blaspheme his name and not repent and not give him glory. Going on to the fifth seal, and when Yeshua had opened the fifth seal, I beheld the lives of those which that were underneath the altar that were sacrificed through Elohim's word and through the testimony of his word that they held. And they cried out with a loud voice, saying, "How long, Yahweh, will you not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth?" And white robes were given to every one of them, and it was told to them that they should rest for yet a little season until it is accomplished or brought to fullness, and also so that their fellow servants and their brethren will be killed in the manner that they were. Yeshua opening this fifth seal was represented by Yahweh holding back his wrath through his timeline in the way that he has. the brethren and the fellow servants is a prophetic reference to the 153 first fruits that were still alive in the flesh at the time of the first fruit harvest. Some of the 144,000 first fruits were killed on a physical plane, but by no means were all of them killed in this way. Yet they received condemnation from those who are of the world and their family members and such. In this manner, the 153 were killed by others and by their family members as well. In the same manner, those of you who return to the Most High by turning to that which He has restored in order to become the planting of the millennium and part of the latter harvest into His family will be persecuted for your choice to do so by your families and such. This is why Yeshua told you to flee from them. Now that the abomination of desolation has been revealed, the Most High has continued to hold back His wrath since His first fruit harvest, but the time of His doing so is fast coming to an end. The yet for a little season is about over with. This fifth seal testifies to Him holding back His wrath even after His first fruit harvest until that which needs to be fulfilled is brought to pass. Verse 12, and I beheld when the Lamb opened the sixth seal, and there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black like the hair of sackcloth, and the moon became like blood, and the stars of heavens fell from the earth in the manner that a fig tree cast off her unripened figs when she is shaken by a mighty wind. His reference to the fig tree and the unripened figs being cast off is a reference to those of you who were not part of His first fruit harvest. You are cast from being harvested because you did not do that which would have caused Him to give you His four spirits. His spirits of wisdom, understanding, counsel, and knowledge lead to eternal life. In the same manner, being cut off from them leads to eternal death. Yeshua opening the seal was represented by the Most High prophesying through His end-time messenger of His covenant, the great and the fearful day of His wrath. This is validated in verse 17 that will be up on the next screen. He has fuddled this day through the testimony of His word in a phenomenal way that has testified to His word and to why He is sending this time of affliction and to whom He is going to send it upon and even to whom He is going to send a double portion of it upon. And that which will result on a physical plane from these seals will come to pass. In verse 14, and the heavens separated in the manner that a scroll is rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of their places. And the kings of the earth and the great men and the rich and the chief captains and the mighty and every bondman and free man hid themselves in the caves and in the rocks of the mountains and said to the mountains and to the rocks, fall upon us and hide us from the face of Him that sits upon the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb, because the great day of His wrath is come, and who will be able to stand? The testimony of His word tells us who will be able to stand. It will be those of you who return to Him through that which He has restored. He goes on with the seventh seal in Revelation chapter 7. With it, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding back the four winds, the four spirits, from the earth, so that the wind or the spirit would not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree. This verse represents Yahweh holding back His four spirits of wisdom, understanding, counsel, and knowledge from those of you who would not turn back to Him through that which He has restored. And I saw another angel, a fifth angel, ascending from the east, from the rising of the sun, having the seal of the living Elohim, the seventh seal, and he cried with a great voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea, saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, until the servants of our Elohim are sealed in their foreheads. And I heard the number of them which were sealed, and there were sealed 144,000 of all of the tribes of the children of Israel. The seventh seal was the sealing of the last of the 144,000. This last sealing took place nearly 2 years ago on the Most High's restored Feast of First Fruits. The second anniversary of this final sealing is just over a couple of weeks away from now. He goes on to list the 12 tribes, the 12,000 of the 12 tribes, leaving out the tribe of Dan and filling the vacant spot by dividing the tribe of Joseph into the tribes of Ephraim and the tribe of Manasseh. He calls the tribe of Ephraim the tribe of Joseph in this prophecy because Jacob gave Ephraim Joseph's firstborn's blessing, even though he was born second to his brother Manasseh. And then we are told, after listing the 12,000 from the 12 tribes, we're told in Revelation 8, and when he had opened the seventh seal, meaning after the last of the 144,000 was sealed, there was silence in heaven, like or in the manner of half of an hour. And I saw the seven angels which stood before Elohim, and the seven trumpets were given to them. The magnificent detail that the Most High has manifested to us ever since he wove in a prophetic tear of the timing of these trumpets the year before his first fruit harvest has been incredible. Through the prophecies that are recorded in his word and the timing of his Passover instructions, he established that the space of a half an hour is a prophetic reference to the 3.5 days that his only begotten son was dead. And from there he wove these 84 hours into different tiers of 84 days in his timeline to reflect this in a magnificent way. And now he has funneled the great and the fearful day of his wrath into the end of the 84 days that encompass his Feast of First Fruits next year and the last day of his Feast of Temporary Dwellings. You should marvel at how he has done this with through the testimony of his word. It is awesome that next year's Feast of First Fruits that kicks off these 84 days is the third anniversary of his first fruit harvest in lieu of the significance that he places upon the number 3 in the testimony of his word. He has continued to tie the different 84-day periods of time into his holding back the major effects of the seven trumpets. Will the 84 days that encompass this year's Feast of First Fruits and the Feast of Temporary Dwellings mark the end of the silence from heaven and the start of him letting loose the full impact of these trumpets? We will soon find out. This verse clearly says that the effects of his seven trumpets are going to be let loose after this space in time, after the last of the 144,000 were sealed. It very well could be after the 84 days that will follow the second anniversary of the sealing. The way that he has manifested the dynamic design of his end time timeline to us has indeed been incredible. And he continues to add to the marvelous design of his word as we march forward to the great and the fearful day of his wrath. This day is fast approaching, and so is the increase of the calamity that he will continue to unleash prior to it that is being sent forth as a result of the seven seals being opened. Turn from your rebellion to him and turn to him through that which he has restored, or else prepare to be a recipient of his hot indignation for your failure to do so. Thus saith the testimony of his word.